This is Dan Schneider, and on this Dan Schneider video interview, the subject will be James A. Emanuel, an American poet who died a couple of years ago. I will be talking with three people about his life and career, and that will begin in a moment.
For a farmer, something slow moves through him, watched by hills. Something low within each rock receives his noonday wish, then crumbles rich. So fills each furrow that the prairie year upheaves. His arm has lain with boulders. His copper hand has mused on roots, uncaring of barbed wire. His fist has closed on thistle and dug the land for corn October snows have whelmed entire. Something flows with him in stubborn streams, and in the parted foliage something lives in upright green, stirred by the rhythmic gleams of his hoe and spade. From worn-out arms he gives. The earth receives, turns all his pain to soil, where he believes and testifies through toil.
This show is going to focus on American poet James Emanuel. I first encountered Emanuel's work about 20 years ago when I came upon a book of his called Collected Poems Whole Grain in a half-price bookstore. It sold for only $4.95. It was several hundred pages long, and as usual, I skimmed through the book and saw the poems were of quality, so I bought it. About 6 or 7 years later, when I started my website Cosmoetica, I wrote, as far as I know, the first critical essay on the works of James Emanuel, at least the first one that saw public light. At the time, there was only two other entries online about James Emanuel. One was a Russian fan site, and the second one was a poem called The Negro on, I think, the Poets and Writers website. So mine was that initial essay called The Not-So-Strange Emanuel Case did seem to lead over the next few years to several dozen other people following or picking up on James's career, posting some poems of his online. James himself, I think, was involved with some of the people in putting some of his work up. And I interviewed James along with Jean McGrin, who you'll see in the center square of our little panel, James's translator, in 2003 on an Omniversica radio show, internet radio show that I was doing at the time. I then, a few years later, interviewed James for my written Dan Schneider interviews, and now this is my sort of biggest foray into talking about the life of the man who died a couple of years ago, I believe in September 2013. The three panelists left to right are Jake Lamar, another American writer based in France, Jean McGrin, also based in France, who translated James's poems, and Alex Sheremet, a young man who I first met on Cosmoetica on the E-List, who has appeared in several film shows that I've done, but who also has read much of James's poetry and is going to be talking about the poems themselves. So let me just start with that preface. Jake Lamar, if you could introduce yourself to the people here, who you are, what you've written, and briefly, in 2 or 3 minutes, your relationship to James Emanuel, please.
Jake Lamar. I was born in the Bronx, New York in 1961. Grew up down the street from Yankee Stadium, went to Harvard University, majored in American history and literature. After graduating in 1983, I worked for Time magazine for 6 years, and quit Time magazine when I got a contract to write my first book, a memoir called Bourgeois Blues, which was published in 1991. I won a prize for that book, which gave me enough money to come to Paris. I plan to stay for a year. I've been here for 22 years now. I've published 6 novels. I've written a play, many essays and reviews. And I'll read later a text I wrote in tribute to James Emanuel. I met him in my early months in Paris, and we were were friends for 20 years.
Let me just ask, did you meet James in an academic setting, at a poetry reading, or just at a regular party or a soccer game or something?
I met him at a cafe through his friend, the poet Ted Jones.
Okay. All right. Jean McGren, if you could just give a little bit of introduction as to who you are, and like Jake, then talk about how you met James Emmanuel and your relationship with the man.
Okay. Well, I'm 77 years old. I taught English at top level in a former life, and I took to translating poetry as early as the late 70s. And that's when I started doing translations, that I was invited in a sort of workshop in Paris called the Festival Franco-Anglais de Poésie, where poets, English-speaking and French-speaking poets from all over the world, met and translated each other and discussed poetry about that. And the year after, I was asked to read a translation, because the translator was not there, and it was a translation by James Emmanuel, of a poem by James Emmanuel. I read the translation, and I saw the man, spoke to him, and said, well, I'm interested in your poetry. Would you like me to translate your work? And at the beginning, he said, uh-huh. And then we met another time, and that was that. That was a deal. We sort of didn't sign a written contract, but we sort of shook hands, and that was that. And I met James A. Emmanuel in 1986, and our friendship lasted 25 years or more.
Okay. Now, Alex Sherriman, like me, never met James Emmanuel, and although I had a couple of phone conversations with James Emmanuel, and also did the Omniversica interview and a written interview, and also wrote to him via old-fashioned snail mail. Alex, did you find out about James first through my essay on Cosmoetica?
Yeah, I found out about him both through the essay as well as the poems that you had on. Back then, I wasn't so interested in criticism. I was more interested in reading good poetry. And, you know, I was able to see instinctively, at least, the material that you had on the website was very good. So I sought out the book. You bought it for $5, I think, at the time. I must have purchased the whole grain book for maybe $20 or so. Now, you know, it's like hundreds of dollars if you want a copy. So that was my first introduction to Emmanuel. Besides my interest in poetry, I'm a poet myself. I'm a novelist and critic. My most recent book is Woody Allen Real to Real, which is the biggest analysis of Woody Allen's films ever written. And I'm working on another novel now. Should be done with it by sometime summer next year. So I'm sort of all over the place in that sense. But when I was first seriously getting into poetry, James Emmanuel was, I guess, one of the key figures in kind of tracing my development.
All right, and we'll allow you and the others to get into talking more in detail in a later segment about James as the artist and the writer. Let us talk then a bit about James Emmanuel. He had written, aside from his poems, he'd written, he had edited an anthology, maybe a couple of anthologies about Black American poetry. And he also wrote The Force and the Reckoning, an autobiography of his life. Probably, I think it's sort of till the mid-80s or so it covered, from his birth in, I believe, was it 1921. So about 6.5 decades of his life. I know he was born in 1921 in Nebraska. Jake, since you seem to have had the most personal relationship with James, could you fill us in maybe a few minutes on his autobiographical background, and then maybe some of the more personal anecdotes about James Emmanuel as you knew him in France?
Yeah, I'd actually like to begin with something I wrote some years ago. I forget what the occasion was, but I wrote a tribute to James.
Okay, go ahead.
Later, I read it at his 90th birthday party. He had a small 90th birthday party in June of 2011.
Okay, go ahead.
So, December 1993. I had been living in Paris for only a few weeks when I met the great beat poet Ted Jones at a reading at the Tea and Tattered Pages bookshop. Ted told me to come by the Café Le Bouquet the next day. I didn't realize at the time that Ted showed up at that café on the Boulevard Saint-Germain every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday between 4 and 6 o'clock, and basically held court at a corner table on the terrace. When I arrived at Le Bouquet on a gray, drizzly Wednesday afternoon, I found Ted sitting with two other African-American men. One, a gravel-voiced fellow sporting a green fedora, was introduced to me as Hart Leroy Bibbs. The third man exuded elegance and intelligence. I'd heard of him before, James Emmanuel. While Ted Jones had the switched-on energy of the eternal hipster, and Leroy Bibbs seemed the very essence of cool, James had an aura of dignity and wisdom about him. Knowing these three men would change my life. They opened my mind to all sorts of possibilities, showed me how a black artist could thrive, traveling, exploring, always learning, and of course, getting the work done. That first day in Le Bouquet, I'd brought along my first book, Bourgeois Blues. Ted turned to the epigraph, saw that it was from Ralph Ellison's Invisible Man. "Play the game, but don't believe in it," Ted began to read. Then, to my utter astonishment, James Emmanuel, who was not looking at the book, quoted the rest of the passage from memory. "That much you owe yourself," James said in his silken baritone. "Even if it lands you in a straitjacket or a padded cell, play the game, but play it your own way, part of the time at least. Play the game, but raise the ante, my boy." A strange and powerful feeling came over me. I was 32 years old and had felt, up until then, very isolated in my situation as an African-American author. Suddenly, listening to James recite Ellison, I felt that I had somehow found my true place, my real community, right there at that cafe table. I was honored when, in February 1994, Ted, James, and Leroy invited me to join them in two readings in celebration of Langston Hughes, first at Shakespeare and Company, later at the Sorbonne. And when the three of them showed up at my first solo reading in Paris the following month, I was touched beyond words. I have another bit in that tribute about James's work. I think I'll read that later. But I had a photo from that reading at the Sorbonne. I'm going to look for it later. I'll show you this picture of myself, James, Ted Jones, and Hartley Bibbs. But James, as I mentioned in that tribute, he had an incredible dignity and gravitas about him. I'm sure Jean can attest to this. There was something very sage-like about James. He could be a very sociable guy. He was great company. He was very funny, you know, with a very dry, wry sense of humor. But in his approach to his work, he was as monk-like a writer as I've ever known. By the time I met him, he'd stripped down his life to his handful of friends and his writing. And to go into James's apartment on the Boulevard Boulevard Montparnasse, it was pristine. He was one of those clean desk writers. You know, he had his typewriter, a stack of papers, and his books, but everything was orderly. Everything in his life was focused to getting the work done in the time he had left. He didn't like to answer his telephone. He had a signal. If you called James, you had to let the phone ring 10 times, and then on the 10th ring, he'd pick up, because he had no time for distractions. He was very much focused on the work. That said, you know, I had, you know, lunches, dinners. My wife and I entertained him in our home He had lots of people who loved him and looked after him, especially in his final days. But he was that aura of gravitas, wisdom, dignity, elegance. That's what I think of when I think about James.
Well, Jake or Jean, let me ask you both. Did James ever talk about growing up in Nebraska? Because one of the things I've noted is Nebraska is a state that's basically almost geographically in the center of the U.S. It's rather sparsely populated, yet a number of interesting and excellent writers came from there, not only James, but John G. Neihardt, the poet, Willa Cather, the novelist, Weldon Keyes, a poet, and Lauren Isley, a naturalist and essayist as well. Either Jean or Jake, if you want to take it, did James ever talk about growing up in Nebraska?
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. He spoke about Nebraska a lot, to me, at least. He was very secretive in a way. He never actually wanted to say things about himself, except whatever had to do with racial prejudice. And that was a sort of wound that's never stopped bleeding in him. And that's what is behind one half, or perhaps two-thirds, of his works as a poet and as the man who wrote the thesis and anthologies about Langston Hughes and other black authors. I think that Nebraska, being of humble origins, is the beginning of everything and the root he never cut off. He wrote, besides and before The Force and the Reckoning, he wrote a biography. I'm going to show you the title of it, if you can see it. That was published in 1993 in Contemporary Authors Autobiography Series, Volume 18. I don't think that many people have that in hand. That's where you can find all that he never said to anybody else later on, including details of his personal life, which was a tragedy. But back to Nebraska, he was proud of saying that he was the best pupil student at school, that he did what you call perhaps the valedictorian speech when he left, that he worked as farm boy, cowhand, I'm quoting him, all the time. Then that when he left in 1940, when he was 18, he went to Des Moines, Iowa, and he worked as an elevator operator, then in a junkyard in Illinois, Rock Island, Illinois, and all that. So his sort of way of his life, from nobody to university professor, he was very proud of, because for him it was a revenge against the situation of a colored person in the US of A. Even in Nebraska, where there were not many blacks around, he all the time felt that segregation was at him. And he recalled the moment when he had taken an exam as a shorthand typist and got the top mark of 98.7%, but he was blacklisted because the paper was marked black across and he never got the job. He sort of found an outlet, he found a way out of that when, after all, he was engaged by the Ministry of Defense in Washington, D.C., and worked for the first black general in the U.S. Army, General Ben Davis, for whom he worked as a private secretary. And that was the beginning of it, having joined the Army. He could therefore apply for university entrance, and that was that.
Jake, just like, yeah, go ahead. Go ahead.
Pick up on what Sean said. James once described himself to me as a cowboy. that, you know, he was out there riding horses, and while you know, as a New Yorker, I think of Nebraska as the Midwest. When James was growing up there, it was the West, and I think James very much thought of himself as a Westerner. And there was something of Gary Cooper about him, the strong, silent type. Mm-hmm. And the years he worked for Benjamin O. Davis were also very important, because there was also a kind of military bearing about James, you know, the cowboy soldier. And I agree completely with Sean that that racism was the big wound in his life. And we can talk more later about biographical details, the tragedies that yeah. occurred in James's life. There was, in addition to this aura of dignity and gravitas, there was a sorrow about James. There was a sadness that was almost palpable when you were in his presence.
Well, I know that when he died, I was one of the first people to contact the New York Times, because while there's no doubt that racial prejudice in America was certainly something that veined some of his work, I was really kind of upset that they sort of diminished him as just a poet who wrote of racism, because if you've ever read any of his poems about the Prospect Park fourth grade children or the death of a spider, he had a bigger purview than that. Yes, he was able to get beyond himself, and that's one of the things that made him a great poet and not just a niche poet. Let me just get back to Jake. Did you get any more personal anecdotes, like something that might have happened in the third grade with Jean, or if he was out with his father fishing one day? Do you have any anecdotes like that he might have shared?
I don't remember any specific anecdote, but he knew a lot about horses. And I remember him talking about how to get a handle on a certain type of misbehaving horse. But he was very much a Westerner, and his experience in that regard is atypical, especially for African Americans of his generation. It wasn't the urban experience. It wasn't the rural South, the Mississippi of Richard Wright, say, or the New York of James Baldwin. It was a Westerner's experience, and I think that gave him a certain individuality. And I agree entirely with what you just said, Dan, about his work. There's a lot about race in his work, but there are brilliant, beautiful poems that have nothing to do with racial questions at all. He had a breadth of interest in the world, in human experience. He was very proud to have traveled all over the world. And I remember one of the things he said, James had a wonderful way of turning cliches on their head. He said, I've traveled all over the world, and if there's one thing I've learned, it's that people everywhere are not the same. The cliche is that, oh, everyone's all the same wherever you go. But he was always struck by the differences in cultures, the differences in the ways people lived their lives.
Yeah, I was just looking on his Wikipedia page, and I'm assuming it's correct, and hopefully some that's notoriously bad website. But I do remember looking there that he did start out at Howard University, which was an all-black university, then moved on to a couple of other more integrated universities. And I do recall him mentioning some of his trips. I do remember him mentioning, did he go to Indochina? I believe he might have mentioned that to me. Or am I, did he ever mention that?
Widely in Asia. I think he traveled widely in Asia. Okay. I'm not sure which specific countries. But in The Force and the Reckoning, this book, which is a mix of autobiography, it's also collected poems. And James, I think, knowing that he wasn't going to get his due in his lifetime, sort of did the sort of thing that a biographer would do. He has in this book the drafts of his poems.
Yeah.
You know, with all of the crossing outs, as you see in these Paris Review collections, when you see artist works, their different drafts. And towards the end of the book, there are photos of his travels. Here's James, yeah. And he, the picture of the Taj Mahal. I'll see in here if I find any reference to Vietnam or Indochina. But it wouldn't surprise me. James James was a very well-traveled man.
Now, let me just ask both you and John, since you knew the man. When did he retire? In the early 90s? When did he retire from his teaching post?
When did James retire?
Yes.
James retired when his son died.
And that was the late 80s?
That was in 1983 or 4, 83.
Okay.
He retired when his son died, and he's written about that. I don't know if it's in The Force of the Reckoning, yeah. But it's in the A Force in the Film, which I have here.
Yeah.
And this is certainly the crucial point in his life, the point of no return. When his son died, he was in New York City with... There's a very difficult point here because I don't want to mention people who are still alive.
Yeah.
He was in New York City in female company, and he got a phone call or whatever, and he learned about that. That was the end of it. He decided to leave the US of A forever and moved to France in the following 6 months.
So did he have a teach in France?
Pardon?
Did he have a teach in France, or did he just do lectures there?
Yes. James taught abroad in Poland. He taught abroad in... He was a Fulbright visiting professor in Grenoble in southern France in 1968. He went the first time to Toulouse University in the southwest of France. That's where he met Marie-France. And then he returned to Toulouse, and from that time on, Marie-France was in his life and has been ever since.
So let's end this segment here. But before I do, since Alex never met James, did you ever read The Force and the Reckoning, Alex?
No, I have not. It's one of the books that I did try to buy it. I mean, I think it's $200-$300 a copy, and it's been like that for a while.
Okay.
It's not really available in libraries around here either. So I don't really have much of a glimpse into his autobiography, except what's online, what's on the long interview that he did on the Amatpersky show about 12, 13 years ago. But beyond that, I don't have much insight into his life.
Okay. Well,
can I say something?
Yeah, go ahead, John.
Look at this, if you can have that.
Yeah.
Michel Favre was a university professor in Paris, and he wrote Black American Writers in France, and that from Harlem to Paris, and that was published by the University of Illinois Press. And I think that you can find many compliments about James' life in this, seen from a Michel Favre point of view. Michel Favre was a very kind, very generous, very bright person who held symposiums on Black American literature in the Sorbonne and other universities in Paris. And he helped James when James settled in France after the death of his son.
Okay. So let's end this segment. When we get back, we'll talk more about James Emanuel.
For the fourth grade prospect school, how I became a poet. My kite broke loose, took all my string and backed into the sun. I followed far as I could go and high as I could run. My special top went spinning down the gutter, down the drain. I heard it gurgling sideways, saw it grinning in the rain, my string wrapped around it while I reached for it in vain. My dog got thin and went away. He took his leash, the wrapping string that we pretended was a rope, and went as far as he could hope to find the sick bed where I lay. And now, when I remember strings and how they bind together things and how they stretch like reach and run and hold like hope and give like sun, I tie together things I know and wind up with a poem to show.
In this segment, I want to talk a bit more in depth about James Emanuel's life and some specific incidents in his career, just to maybe get some things straight for any future biographers that might watch this. But I wanted to step back a little bit and get Alex involved a little bit. He'll chime in a bit more later on when we talk specifically about the man's writing. But I wanted Alex to talk about a poem of his that, or a poem of James that influenced him and explain why he thinks it is a good or a great poem, and then sort of go back and talk a bit more about James, his life and his philosophy in writing and life. So, Alex, you mentioned during the break there was a poem you wanted to speak about. If you could just mention the poem, talk a little bit about what it is and why it influenced you.
The name of the poem is To Kill a Morning Spider. I first read it back in 2008 when I got the whole Great Poems collection. And you mentioned in several essays and interviews the influence that Robert Frost's poem design probably had on James Emanuel's poem. But in reading this one, I'd probably rank it in maybe the top three or four poems that Emanuel had written. We mentioned the universal aspect of his poetry. Yes, Emanuel wrote on black topics, but he's not exclusively some sort of black writer. He never stereotyped himself. He never pigeonholed himself. And in fact, he hated anything that, you know, would more or less sort of put somebody into one tiny little category. He's very broad. And in this poem in particular, it has a sort of feel of just a very strong mythic quality. You know, at the beginning, it's a series of images. There's this spider that the narrator finds in his shoe. He ends up killing it, mostly out of surprise. But the thing that what makes it so special is the ending. The ending calls upon this image of human beings sort of being these watchers. You know, we wake up, we do these things, we act almost like robots. And this is perhaps the way that, you know, animal life might perceive us. If there's any sort of intelligent life below us, they would see us and they don't understand our motivations. They don't understand why we would, you know, be on this bed for 8 hours before waking up and, you know, doing this thing and destroying other life forms. They don't understand what we do in our spare time. They don't understand how we eat, how we live. They understand nothing about us. And this can be extrapolated to so many things beyond what's happening in the poem itself. You could extrapolate this into, you know, higher life forms other than us. You know, we might not be able to understand what's happening, you know, elsewhere in the cosmos. Lauren Isley, the other writer from Nebraska, mentioned that we can't prove, for example, that we don't exist on the back of some kind of vast cosmic beast. And if we would, it would be beyond our comprehension, beyond our perception. And the fact that this Emanuel poem, it is fairly short, it's for me been a kind of model of greatness in the sense that there's definitely a feel about it that when you read it, you know that this is what a great poem looks like. You know what it sounds like. You know that the rhythm is absolutely perfect for this end. It has a sort of masterly quality that when you read it, it does have the gravity, it does have the seriousness, it does have the classical rhythm of a great poem, despite it being, free verse. So, and the way that it sort of ends and connects everything all together in a very kind of distilled and concise moment of just enlightenment and cross connection, you know, this is the sort of thing that poetry needs to strive for. I don't think there's a similar great poem out there or any great work of art that doesn't make this kind of connection, that doesn't make this kind of leap, and that doesn't do it in this sort of economy. So I, going into James Emanuel's poetry and, you know, beyond looking at some of the black writing, the writing on racism and whatnot, there's very much an instructional aspect to it. If you want to learn how to write great poetry, you look at these sorts of connections, you look at these sort of things that he was able to do, and you learn how to imitate that and eventually transcend it. So it's definitely been a special poem for me in that regard, especially since around the times when I really started writing poetry was around 2008. And it's been important in that sense, and, you know, I return to it time and again, specifically for this purpose.
Well, I did do, I think, a few poem videos of James reading his poems that I culled from the Omniversco show, and I'm going to insert them between these segments. And so you people listening will be able to listen to James actually reading that poem. I believe that's one of them. So let's turn a bit back more biographically now. I saw Jake preparing something. I know you said during the break you had a piece you had written, James had written about around the time of his son's death. Since that seems to be, as what Jean McGren had said, was a key marker in James's life, at least in his later life, let's talk about that, because I know when we did the Omniversca show, Jean, he did not want to talk about that at all, and he just sort of skims over it in The Force and the Reckoning. I don't have the book that you mentioned. He went into more detail about it. His son's name was James Emanuel Jr., and where did this happen in California, I believe, that his son was killed or beaten, and then he killed himself?
Go ahead, Jake. First, I wanted to show this photo. I hope it's visible. Yeah. This is in front of the Sorbonne in Paris. This is February 1994. I'm the young guy in the middle. The fellow in the beret is Ted Jones. The fellow in the fedora is Hart Leroy Bibbs. And there on the other side of me is James Emanuel.
Okay.
This is at a reading we gave to honor Langston Hughes' birthday. Ted Jones every year organized a reading around Langston Hughes' birthday, February 1st. And again, these were my first months in Paris, and these three men were sort of my Paris fathers. James and I did several readings together, and once we were invited to Grenoble to give a reading in support of Mumia Abdjamal. That's a whole long story about the writer who was imprisoned in Philadelphia. But I was in Grenoble with James, and he mentioned that he had once lived in Grenoble as a Fulbright scholar with his wife and son in the late 60s. And I said, where's your son now? And James said to me in French, il est mort. He's dead. I think James couldn't even bring himself to say in English, he's dead. He then said to me, I wrote a poem about it. I said, I'm sorry. James said, I wrote a poem about it called Deadly James. And James is such a, you know, if you heard him read, he had such an amazing voice. I said to him, oh yeah, I think I heard you read that poem. And he said, no. I've never read that poem in public. But because his voice was so much in my head, when I had read that poem, I had heard him reading it. I'd imagined hearing him reading it. He never read the poem in public. But after his death in 2013, I read the poem at the ceremony where his ashes were interred in the wall at the Père Lachaise Cemetery in Paris. The story is this. James's son was in his early 20s, I think. He was living in San Diego. He was arrested for no reason. He was in police custody for some time. He was beaten by the police. And soon after he was released from police custody, he was completely traumatized by this event, and after some time, after this unlawful arrest, he committed suicide with a rifle. And James called that the wound he never recovered from. Jean, would you like to add something about that?
Yes. As far as I know, the suicide took place in Chicago. James Jr. had left San Diego, and there was some time, perhaps a couple of years, between the beating and the harassment and what happened in Chicago, where James told me that the harassment never ceased for various reasons. Now, he didn't want to speak about it, except that at some times he had to. And you could feel it. He had to express it. Yes, you're right, he never read his Deadly James poem in public, but he let me read the French translation when we had readings together in Irish pubs in Paris. And you could tell that this was heartrending for him. When he published the book called Deadly James, of which Deadly James is the title poem, he was looking for somebody to illustrate the book. And I supplied a person, Nicole Lamotte, a French friend of mine, who made a portrait of James Jr. from a photo that James Sr. obligingly gave. And when he received, and I was there, when he received the engraving, the drawing, nearly killed him, and he had it pinned in his room in Paris forever after.
Yes,
so that was the tragedy of his life, the culmination of his uneasiness at being a black militant in a racist country. I'm afraid this, to me, with the theme of love and women, remains the most important part of his poetry, but his art came first, and the topic came second.
Yes. In fact, I found what James wrote about this in The Force and the Reckoning.
Go ahead.
Those touches of gender magic, whenever I could feel them as nourishment and stable. Okay. Speaking of his son, Deadly James, as his son James, the news of his suicide by rifle in Michigan, received over the telephone in New York, pinned me against the kitchen wall. I remember my arms stretched high, clutching at it as if I were trying to climb over it. Mary France standing there, wide-eyed, one hand raised. Emptiness. His death, the wound from which I never recovered, raised a wall, in the words of a title by Richard Wright, between the world and me. Its causes, important in firming my view of the world, were twofold. Racism motivated police brutality in California, where he suffered a 2-inch skull fracture from beatings in jail, and subsequent court-based harassment pursuing him to Michigan, dependent on the police report charge of assault with a deadly weapon, identified as a book satchel. My life turning a corner in January 1983 has not followed old paths since then, a veil lifting and lowering itself as if moved by a moral force obeying its own kinetic laws, still shadows my memory of the past 13 years. In conformity, then, with the legacy of Deadly James, gave up his life rather than submit to injustice, I end this chronicle with a kind of eulogistic silence as a salute to good men that died before their time and to good probabilities that never came to fruition.
I was going to ask after Jean had stated the word harassment, so I assume that young James had been threatened with being taken back to court, so that's why he left the state of California. Is that correct, Jean?
No idea.
No?
Okay. No idea. But if James Jr. took after his father, he must have been a militant and had taken active part in the racial conflict or advancement of the colored races in the United States. But James never said anything about what his son did in those days when he, between the age of 20 and the age of 30. He never said anything about that to me.
Okay. Let's just take a little step back, because Jake had earlier mentioned the early 60s with James and his wife living there. Now, in my almost decade and a half since I first encountered James via you, John, I know that he had several women in his life, white European women. Was James only married once? Was he married to a black American woman? What?
Yes, he was. He was married to a black American woman. He married her when he was at Howard University. And he divorced after his stay in Grenoble. The argument, the idea was that his wife got mad in a way, and that she saw ghosts or whatever. To me, there is something else behind it, much more important. He went to Grenoble with his wife and son, who was then about 13 or 14. And I think that the wife was not of the same metal that James was, as far as harassment, racial problems were concerned. And that what she saw clearly, that James breathed another air when he was in Grenoble, and that his eye was on white ass, to take up one of his favorite phrases. And that, I think, was the beginning of the end. The circumstances are rather sordid, and I don't want to say more about that.
Okay.
I never heard James say anything about white ass, but if you read in The Force and the Reckoning, his wife was pretty clearly a paranoid schizophrenic, and her troubles began when they were still living in the United States. Often, this is from James's autobiography, often during the 2 years, 1966-68, about 4 a.m., I was stirred from sleep by fingernails digging into my shoulders and moist lips pressing my ears with fragmentary accounts of the machinations of miscellaneous people in Mount Vernon, where they were living at the time, and at Columbia University to drive her insane. Watch out, the labored breath would always conclude, an arm squeezing me with, "They're after you too." Groggy with mixed before dawn memories, I habitually rose from bed, surprised to see a relaxed, half-smiling face on the pillow behind me, too easily awakened, however, by any uncalm gesture that I might make. So this madness manifests itself before they got to Grenoble. By the time they did get to Grenoble, as you know, from what I know of paranoid schizophrenia, it just gets worse and worse over time. So she's wandering around the house, she's hearing voices, the mild exhortation, his mother resuming her practice of, she's speaking of James, his son now, his mother, James's wife, resuming her practice of pre-dawn in-bed confidences, had whispered to me that a voice had been telling her to kill both him and me. So the wife is clearly insane.
Yeah.
And yes. I don't know what happened to her after the divorce, but I did hear that perhaps she was
institutionalized. Yes. You're reading James's version,
which I consider pretty reliable.
You don't know the other side of the story, neither do I. And I think there is more behind it than one might be tempted to.
Well, let's leave that for any future biographer to delve in. We don't have an infinite amount of time to sort through people's psychologies.
Yes.
Let me step back a little bit.
Yet one point.
Go ahead.
There is a poem called "Ass on the Beach in Spain," which you have in my De la Rage au Coeur anthology, Earth on the Beach in Spain, which is plain enough.
I just read it a few days ago, so I can imagine him going down the beach and having a very good time.
Yes.
All right. Well, let's that.
Women liked James, and he loved women.
Okay.
That's for sure.
Well, let's step back a little bit to the early 60s and whatnot, and let's talk a little bit about James in academia as a teacher and a professor. Who are some of the people? I mean, we did mention he edited an anthology, but who are some of the people that maybe he influenced, other than you, Jake, that he may have mentioned that had come through his classes?
You know, I remember him talking more about people who had influenced him, especially Langston Hughes. He didn't talk much about people who had followed in his path. And you've pointed out, Dan, some of the things you've written about James, and you've written very astutely about his work. I think part of the reason he isn't more recognized is because he doesn't fit any particular movement. You can't say that he was like Ted Jones, a beat generation poet. I mean, he and Ted were of the same generation, but there's nothing in the beat style about James's poetry. And as Alex pointed out in the To Kill a Morning Spider and in many of his other poems, there's a kind of timeless quality about James's work, as you do find in say Robert Frost, you know, these poems, or Yeats, these poems that sound like they've existed forever, carved in granite, and I think that makes him very hard to get a handle on. I've known lots of people who've admired his work. I haven't met poets who said they were influenced by him. I haven't met a poet who said, oh yeah, aside from Alex today, I haven't met a poet who said, I read James Emmanuel and that made me want to write in a certain way. I think he's very much his own man. And in that early poem, I think it's called Sonnet for a Poet, Sonnet for a Writer, it's astonishing how early that poem was, because he knew exactly what he wanted to do. As a writer, he knew that he was going to follow his own solitary path. And I think this is part of the reason why it's so difficult for academia to place him. He doesn't fit any movement.
Go ahead, John. You look like you wanted to say something.
Yes. I think that there is an explanation to that. James Emmanuel, most, if not all, his poems are rooted in his own self, his own experience, but they open onto the universal. They are epiphanies, exactly like most of James Joyce's short stories. Joyce never wrote about anybody else but himself, but his work is universal. That's about the same thing with James. Mutatis mutandis, as you say, we can say in Latin, things being what they are.
Let me just ask both Jean or Jake, since James would have sort of been in his heyday in terms of his teaching career during the turbulent 60s in America, did he ever talk to you about his feelings on the civil rights movement, the anti-war, the anti-Vietnam movement, and what was his relationship to maybe some of his superiors at the universities he may have taught at during that time? Because there was quite a bit of the generation gap. John, you look like you're ready. Go ahead.
Yes, the war in Vietnam, I don't think there is much about it. But when he was teaching in New York City, he lived in Mount Vernon, and he was engaged in local politics. And there he was more or less victimized by people of his own community, thinking that he was either too black or not black enough. And he even wrote a poem about that. But so he was deeply involved in politics, and there is a short brochure called Black Panther Poems, which he wrote in his early days. He was indeed deeply immersed in the fight for rights, for human rights.
Jake, you have a comment?
Well, I would say he didn't speak much to me about it in conversation. But if you just look at some of the titles of his poems in the 60s and 70s, there's the fantastic poem called The Negro. There's a poem about Emmett Till called Emmett Till. There's Old Black Men Say. There's For Young Blacks, The Lost Generation. There's another poem to Martin, to Luther, to King. A poem called A Black Militant Poem Speaks. African America, The Garden, Seeds and Seasons. He was not a political poet per se, but when he tackled these issues, Panther Man, yeah, terrific collection. I think he tackles these issues in what I call a humanist way. That racism for him is a human quality. And so the poems might deal with political issues, but they're never polemical.
If you
define the distinction there. He's not coming at you with a program. He's not saying he hates whitey or anything like that. It's always grounded in human experience and in universal themes, even though the subject is racism.
He got over it, and this was sublimated in this most important book, Jazz from the Haiku King, which is another approach to blackness as a system or whatever in the world.
Alex, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, one of my favorite poems that he did was actually Emmett Till. Many people know the story, for those that don't. There was a boy that was, I think it was in the 40s or 50s.
Early 50s.
He was accused of whistling at a white woman, so he was killed by a group of white men, and they put a gin mill around his neck, and they drowned him in the river. This poem, it's a very short poem. It rhymes. You don't expect that to happen. It has a very much like an extreme childlike quality, and I can think of all the journalistic pieces that were written about Emmett Till, or all the late poetry that's been written about it, or the manifestos, anything else that you can think of, and as much as you could expound the facts, as much as you could say, and politicize everything, he probably captured the kind of terror of Emmett Till far better than anything I've ever read. I mean, it's like, I think, 10, 11 lines, and it more or less sounds like a fairy tale, and it ends with Emmett Till, the image of him being necklaced in a coral toy, referring to the gin mill, and just that kind of image and that kind of childlike curiosity about it, it captures it so much better, and as was said, in a far more universalist light than all the polemics you could think of. And it's more frightening by the fact that it's now a fairy tale. The serious thing is now something that little boys could inquire about. It's a scary story that they could hear, at least in the universe of that poem. And he was very, very good at that. And it is definitely one of the early poems that has always stuck with me.
Well, let me just talk, since Jean had touched about it briefly when he was talking earlier. I know that in some of the letters that I got from James Emmanuel, and also once or twice I did speak with him on the phone at one of his lady friends' homes, he did, I wouldn't say that he got sort of paranoid, but he did seem to have a really big axe to grind against certain unenumerated black scholars and academics. And he said that he felt that his work had been blacklisted, not by white America, but by a lot of the black poets and academics publishing there. Now, I don't want to get into any libel things. We don't need to name any names of anyone still alive. But so please don't name anyone alive. But was I the only person he ever mentioned that to, Jean or Jake? Did he ever reveal any of this sort of bitterness that he had against the black publishing establishment, if we want to call that, in America?
I would refer to you to referring to his poem "The Blacklist."
Yeah.
A dialogue in a Harlem bar, and it's two guys talking about black writers who have been blacklisted, deliberately marginalized, and ignored. And there, James sort of takes it head on. Yeah, he was fresher than academia because he knew academia, and he knew how things worked in the ivory towers. I think James, and get back to this question of recognition. I think James couldn't accept the fact that literary reputation is not based on a meritocracy. As a scholar, as a man with a lot of integrity, he wanted to believe that sooner or later good writers would be recognized. But, you know, the lack of recognition, that this is an old story. Herman Melville was a customs officer for years after he wrote Moby Dick, and nobody read it. When F. Scott Fitzgerald died in 1940, he was washed up. He was a has-been. Obituaries didn't even mention The Great Gatsby. If William Faulkner had died in 1949 instead of winning the Nobel Prize, I don't know that American readers would ever have discovered him. Thanks to Europe, that America discovered William Faulkner. His books were trashed in places like The New Yorker, just spat on. So James's fate was not an uncommon one, but I think he, and the reasons why, there are a lot of them. I heard the beginning of the radio, the telephone interview you did with him, Dan, a few years ago. He mentioned the fact that he lived in Paris as maybe being one of the reasons why he hadn't gotten his due. And I think there's probably something to that as well. James was not somebody who was going to be hobnobbing at literary cocktail parties, no matter where he lived. But there is a lot of socializing that can go into advancing a writer's career, especially in New York. And James just wasn't having it. But he did look with a somewhat jaded eye at let's say the generation of black academics who became well known in the 80s and 90s, and I think he felt that a lot of them were more interested in advancing their own careers rather than celebrating literature.
Jean, go ahead.
Yeah, later in his life, he was very proud when he told me that he was visited, physically, I mean, not ghosts, but we'll go back to this in a moment. He was visited by American teachers, sometimes with classes, who went up the 98 steps to his flat in Boulevard Montparnasse to see the man, speak to the man, and he was very pleased. So he did want recognition. And when I first suggested that I might translate his poems, he jumped on the opportunity. He was very pleased. He had tried to get some of his poems published in Paris. He even showed me, but I don't know where it is. It's lost somewhere in my library, on my files. He showed me a little booklet that somebody had began, but he wasn't satisfied because there was three or four things. When I published him, I started a publishing firm with friends. I invested money. I lost the money, but I published 50 poems of his. It took me 3 years to complete the book, but he was very, very pleased. And I know he was proud, especially because there was also illustrations by this person, Nicole Lamotte, who had done the illustration for his Deadly James book. So he was dying for recognition, but he was too much of a gentleman to show any feeling about that.
Well, let's step back again here, because we did cover his youth. Let's talk about his World War II years, and it was mentioned Benjamin O. Davis he had served as sort of the private secretary for. I know that both in the Omniverska show that I did in 03 with him and Jean, he mentioned a little bit about that. I know in some snail mail to me, he talked a little bit more about that. And I think I mean, we mentioned that his son was the turning point in his later life. I got the sense, and I could be wrong, you can correct me if I am, but I got the sense that outside of his writing life, that in his personal life, his years during the 40s serving with General Davis was probably the most influential thing on him as a person, but also seemed to be, I guess I would say, the thing that sort of validated himself, that he, I'm not that he may have had doubts about himself as a youth, but seemed to say that, okay, here I am a person of substance and worth, and he looked at Davis as someone who had achieved that, albeit in another field, that he could maybe follow some kind of a trajectory. Maybe Jean or Jake, let's start with Jake first. Did he ever mention his years with Davis or during the war and anything? Has anything I said, does that resonate with anything he may have said to you?
It resonates with what I read in The Force and the Reckoning more than anything he ever said to me, though I know he was proud to have worked for General Davis. And he says in The Force and the Reckoning that General Davis sort of, he was the most distinguished black person James had met up until that time. You know, James came from, you know, the rural west in Nebraska, and Benjamin Davis just had, you know, he was a general, he had an aura of command and this authority, this dignity. And I think it would have been interesting to meet General Davis and see him with an older James Emanuel. I wouldn't be surprised if much of James's sort of manner came from that. But James was part of that that so-called greatest generation. He was born in 1921. He served with pride and honor. And I also think that in the Army, it was the first time he was surrounded by other African-Americans. The Army was segregated back then, of course. And while in Nebraska there were black families, it was overwhelmingly a white state. And it's in the Army, he's in the Army before he goes to Howard University. It's in the Army that that he really discovered a vast African-American community and got into music and slang and had a sense of how other black people lived. After that, after the war, he went to Howard and on to New York and then the world. But I think certainly his time with General Davis was crucial.
Sean?
There's not much I can say about that because he never broached the subject, really. The only thing is that, yes, those 2 years he spent in Washington, D.C., and then later he went into active service in the Philippines. But this sort of made a person out of the black man, James A. Emanuel. He became a person because he realized, through the example of the general, that a black person could become somebody.
All right, well, let's
Here's a picture from The Force and the Reckoning of James in his uniform.
Yeah.
Uniform.
Yeah.
Very proud, very strict, very stiff.
Yeah.
All right, well, let us end this segment on James's life. And in the next segment, we'll talk more about some of the writing. We'll talk about the autobiography, The Force and the Reckoning. We'll talk about James's evolution as a writer from his earliest days through his heyday, through his last couple of decades. And we'll do that in a moment.
Sonnet for a Writer. Far rather would I search my chaff for grain, and cease at last with hunger in my soul, than suck the polished wheat another brain refurbished till it shone by art's control, to stray across my own mind's half-hewn stone and chisel in the dark, in hopes to cast a fragment of our common self. My own excels the mimicry of sages past. Go forth, my soul, in painful, lonely flight, even if no higher than the earthbound tree, and feel suffusion with more glorious light, nor envy eagles their proud brilliancy. Far better to create one living line than learn 100 sunk in fame's recline.
All right, in this segment, I want to talk more specifically about the writings of James Emanuel, maybe get into a little bit of exegesis of the poems. But before that, Jean, now you can raise it up. I want to talk a little bit about Dark Symphony, Negro Literature in America, an anthology of poems that James had edited, I believe, in the late 60s. And it was a fairly... Okay, Alex has it too. So it was a fairly influential book in regarding to Black American or African American poetry specifically. So well, let me start with Alex this time. Since you raised the book up, have you read that book, Alex? And if so...
I actually just received it yesterday, so I
okay.
have not.
All right, well, let me start with John since you held it up, and then I'll go to Jake. Let's talk a little bit about that book. And I know, I think one of the two of you had mentioned that he was proud of that book. Talk about who's in the book and James's role, if you know anything about that in that anthology, editing it.
Well, who is in the book? Lots of people, plenty of them. The interesting point is that it was edited by James A. Emanuel and Theodore L. Groves, a white person. And so this was a collaboration on Black literature, and James was very proud, again, to let me know that it had served as a textbook in all those parts of the American educational system when they started, when they initiated the teaching of Black American literature. And I hit, well, I don't remember where and when, I hit upon one American woman poet who said that when she arrived at Chicago University when she was 19, she didn't even think that there could be such a subject as Black American literature. And so she sort of went, she attended the course, and the book was Dark Symphony. She never said it was by James Emanuel. She must have forgotten the name of the author. But this was his, I suppose, still is, a very influential book.
Jake?
As we studied that book, or selections from that book, I studied them in junior high school, 1973, 1974. I was introduced to that book and the selections from it. So I did tell James when I, in our the early years of our friendship, how important that collection, that anthology was for me.
Well, let's, the book was published in 1968.
Okay. Well, let us then talk about the trajectory or the arc of James's career. And any one of you can jump in. Does James, like many other poets, would you guys consider that he has distinct periods like many other artists or writers? Certainly the last 20 or so years of his life, 25 years, was mainly the jazz haiku. He had written most of his major poems by probably the mid-80s. I think the Prospect School poem might have been one of the last ones in the mid to late 80s that he wrote. Did he start off a more traditional poet in terms of meter and rhyme, and then move more into free verse? Did his poetry get more political? Alex, let's start with you since...
From what I can tell in Old Rain, the earliest poems sometime, I think in the mid to late 40s, they're very much traditional in the sense of strict rhythm, strict meter, strict rhyme. And most of them are actually not very good. They're just sort of like almost kind of like experiments in form. It's something I don't expect from a poet that's just starting out and trying to see what they could do. You do notice every once in a while an interesting turn of phrase, or you notice in a poem like there's a special kind of conceit that
it's a sort of perspective that you wouldn't necessarily take, and this is something that appears over and over again as poetry. But for the most part, it was just very kind of a rigid and strict, and in general, he didn't do that form very well that early on, although very quickly after that, that's when he wrote Sonnet to a Writer, which is a great sonnet, another great sonnet, Sonnet to a Farmer. So he definitely succeeded in that kind of form. It took him a little bit, and he eventually moved on to, you know, pretty much doing many other things, a free verse, you know, things that sort of fell somewhere in between. And I'd say that the dominant thing that appears in his poems over and over again is what I mentioned earlier. He has conceits and perspectives that you don't necessarily expect. For example, he, you know, has a poem where a narrator is traveling and notices a scarecrow hanging from a tree, and you know, this brings a little bit unexpectedly, this brings some issues of racism up. Or it could be, you know, a girl standing at a sink and suddenly, you know, there's a tiny moment that becomes something far greater, becomes almost like a metaphor for his life or somebody else's life, or, you know, for writing or for reading, or just some kind of engagement with the cosmos. So these are things that crop up over and over again. I'm not sure if I necessarily put him into distinct periods, but you do notice a drop off in quality from the very beginning, and I'd also argue a drop in quality somewhere in the very end.
Go ahead, Jake.
Sorry, one thing I noticed just going through the titles in this collection that he includes in The Force and The Reckoning, how much race is an issue in the poems from the 60s and the 70s. But I think once he gets to Europe, his vision expands. I'm not saying that he always wrote about race in the 60s and the 70s, but if you just look at the titles, once he gets to Europe, he divides this book into decades, poems from the 60s, 70s. Once he gets to the 80s, the subject matter grows. And I think he was sort of freed, as has been the experience of a lot of African-Americans in Europe, freed from just the daily hassles of being black in America. And it helped him expand his vision as a writer. Race becomes less of a preoccupation, and works become broader. And then on in the 90s, he turns to the haiku form. I think his late stuff is pretty strong, I have to say. I think the jazz haiku are rather extraordinary. If I could finish reading this this tribute that I wrote to him,
yeah, go ahead.
10 years ago or so, I could go on and on about James's writing, the brilliance and profound depth of feeling in his work. But let me concentrate on one particular set of poems, the jazz haiku. There is nothing else like them that I know of in world literature. Using the strict Japanese form to evoke such free-form music was, in itself, a stroke of genius. But what is truly magnificent is the way James makes you hear the artist he writes about. I cannot grasp by what alchemy James managed to evoke in words the sound of Miles Davis's trumpet, John Coltrane's saxophone, Billie Holiday's voice. The haiku are imbued with the combination of discipline and play, improvisation and exactitude, inspiration and perspiration that defines the music James so beautifully describes. This is the work of a master artist. It has been one of the great privileges of my life to know him. I think by the time he gets to the haiku, it's just part of his whole stripping everything down. You know, he's getting into his 70s and 80s, and he's aware he doesn't have forever to go on writing. And just as he just sort of stripped down other aspects of his life, I think he stripped down his poetry. And the haiku form just sort of fit into where he was in his life at that time.
John, let's talk about your ideas about James's overall writing career, and then I want to talk specifically about any difficulties you may have had in translating James vis-a-vis other poets you may have translated, how translatable he was, because I did a couple of shows, actually, a couple of months ago on poetry translation with Edward Snow, a noted American translator of Rilke, and a couple of other people, Harold Wright, who had done translations of Japanese poetry. But before we get into the translations, give me your ideas about the overall arc of James's poetic career.
James's poetic career began in 1933 when he was in junior high at Alliance, I first read one of my poems to an audience. He was 12. So he started writing poetry very early. His first poems are, I'd say, up to classical standards, but I can't tell how, why, or when he shifted to poems that were free verse. I've no idea. I didn't research it. I could have done it, but I didn't do it. His haiku writing began in the 70s. The first haiku I know concerned with his personal relationship with Marie-France, when Marie-France was suffering from depression or whatever it was. That's not new, but he gradually, as Jake said, he gradually stripped down his writing to such more than concise pieces of poetry. And when he asked me to translate that, I said, well, you cannot write that they are translated, but just adaptations. You can't translate his haikus. First of all, you've got to know what he has to say. Jazz, he had jazz in his blood. I didn't. I'm not from the same part of the world. And his culture was such that I had to ask him many questions, but I always ask questions to the people I translate in their life. So translating the haikus is really du grand art, I would say in French, something that is a relish to do, but it's very dangerous because you can fall very easily. Translating James has been a years-long process. We corresponded mostly by fax, but I visited him many times in Paris, and he visited me over. Went over to Caen, and we discussed things that mostly were connected with his own private experience. Things that the details of I could not imagine because I had lived them. So, since most of his poetry stems from his personal experience, I had to know what he had actually felt, said, lived in the circumstances, so that I could recapture and reproduce the atmosphere, or the music, or the tone.
If I could just interject, I've taught James's haiku, James's jazz haiku, in English and in French, and I can tell you, Jean, you did a fantastic job.
That's because I have a musical ear, and my music is at most is French. But I tried to adapt, and my idea of what a good translation ought to be is that it is writing another poem that is faithful to the first original wording, but because it's in French, the music is absolutely and totally different because there are no two vowel sounds that are the same in both languages.
Jean, let me just ask, what percentage of James's corpus of several hundred poems do you think that you've translated? 50% or more? And can you...
First of all, let me say that there are poems he never showed me. There are poems I discovered through you.
Yeah.
Such as the two sonnets. Sonnets to a farmer and to a writer. I never heard about that before. And so he selected poetry. We published 50 plus a few odd haikus. I published, I don't know how many haikus in the Jazz or the Haiku thing, and I published a few things in various booklets or publications. Let's say that published, it's about 60, 70, translated but not selected, about 150.
Okay. Did you notice anything, if you're comparing the, say, poems from the 50s and 60s versus the later poems, did the formal structure of some of the earlier poems that Alex mentioned, did that aid in translating, or were the freer poems of the later years somehow easier to translate?
I am able to translate poetry that rhymes into French poetry that rhymes. For instance, I've just done and published online, you know, Daniel Defoe's The True Born Englishman, about 3,000 lines rhyming couplets. I've done that. And it rolls along and it's superb. It all depends whether I cuddle up with the author. There are poems I just can't do anything about. And there are, we have Steven Spender, for instance, there are poems I could not translate. But the jazz haiku, I was free to do what I wanted because James had said, well, you can adapt. Because I said, I can't translate. So it all depends on my feeling.
Okay, well, let's talk strictly then about James's place in sort of the canon of poetry, both American poetry, world poetry, and specifically Black poetry. Let me start with Alex, since I know, Alex, you've read a lot of poetry, and where would you rank? Let's move out. Let's start with the most specific. Compared to some of his contemporaries in Black American poetry of the 20th century, the Gwendolyn Brookses, the Robert Haydens, the County Cullens, who was a little bit earlier, where would you put, would rank James? And then let's move out and talk about some more of his more specific contemporaries, like a Robert Lowell or an Allen Ginsberg.
I'd probably put him among maybe like the big four in Black poetry. That would be James Emanuel, County Cullen, Robert Hayden, and Langston Hughes. The interesting thing about him is he was able to do things a little bit differently, in the sense that, if you look at a poet like County Cullen, as great as the poems are, they are primarily just in one sort of kind of style. They are formal. He did the sort of a semi-capital R romantic thing very well, but he did more or less work kind of in one style and almost one mood. Langston Hughes was very diverse. I'd say probably the one that I see most affinity with is Robert Hayden, and that's both because of diversity and also because of the way that just both are able to compress greatness very, very well in ways that you don't necessarily expect. With Robert Hayden, it's, you know, it could be some of his sonnets, such as those Winter Sundays, that you don't necessarily expect it to be a sonnet as you're reading it. You don't necessarily expect it to end in the way that it does. James Emanuel has quite a bit of that, you know, all over the place, both in the formal and free verse things that he did. So as far as the Black poets go, he's definitely somewhere in the top five. And of the four that I listed, I consider them to be the four best Black poets, and he's definitely among them for that reason. I don't know if I've ever read a truly visionary Black poet in the sense of a Hart Crane or Wallace Stevens, but as far as, you know, what has been available, you know, he's definitely in the top there somewhere.
How about the Robert Lowells and the Allen Ginsbergs, the people born, say, in the same decade as James? That would be like the Donald Halls or someone like that. Where would you put him in just American poetry, regardless of color?
Given the number of great poems that he has, I would definitely rank him as a great poet, you know, regardless of color. Interestingly, you know, you have poets like Robert Lowell, and you have, you know, poets that have great material, but it tends to be sometimes pretty inconsistent. Somebody like Wallace Stevens, you know, is a very wildly consistent poet. You know, even in the things that aren't very good, they're still good in the sense that, you know, they're still kind of opaque, and the images are either startling or there's something there that, you know, there's very little that you could sort of frown upon. With James Emanuel, you know, I think it's more so a function of his age and kind of the unfortunate selection that he made with Gold Brain, in the sense that he decided to put in some of those really, really early poems, you know, before he, you know, did great formal poetry like Sign for a Writer. He decided to include some of the very early stuff. But besides that kind of material, he, you know, he's extremely consistent. You know, he does not have bad poems. He does not really have too many bad lines. You know, probably if you look at his entire collection in that book, at least, you know, you could probably count, you know, maybe on one or two hands the number of bad lines or phrasings that he has. You know, as a poet, there are things that I might somewhat disagree with, you know, perhaps aesthetically, but in terms of objective judgment, he's very, very consistent. And I don't think that's something that artists typically do. You know, you could say great things about Ezra Pound, you could say great things about Robert Lowell, you could say great things about Robert Jeffers, but there's, as far as consistency goes, I feel like cutting out, you know, portions of James Emanuel do him a disservice. On the other hand, cutting out portions of Robinson Jeffers, even with the really good poems, it doesn't necessarily do him that sort of disservice. So it's a very interesting thing that Emanuel's able to do, in the sense that, you know, he could keep his collection whole. On top of the fact that, you know, with some of the lighter poems, some of the stuff that he did that's kind of, you know, he would consider doggerel, or some of the material that's just meant to be light, it's still very interesting material. You know, it could be funny, it could be witty, it's clever. You know, it's not something that could stand the test of time, but, you know, it has that, you know, nice kind of Ogden Nash quality to it. And, you know, that's not something that a Lowell would be able to do. It's not something that a Jeffers would ever be able to do. You know, they not only had no interest, but they probably, you know, couldn't, you know, maybe even get themselves into that sort of mindset. So I feel, as far as that diversity goes, you know, that's something that's going for him that a number of great poets that we've talked about don't necessarily have to their advantage.
John McGren, do you know enough about American poets of James's generation to sort of put him in context or on a continuum?
If I'm going to say something about Ginsberg has a lot of gushing energy all over the book, all over the poems. James is standing back. But James is full of resentment on the one hand, of humor and love on the other. That's what makes his originality. I've been recently working on a few poems by Gwendolyn Brooks, and particularly on In the Mecca, the long, about 800 lines poem.
Yeah.
And I find many correspondences between phrases or the tone or the spirit or whatever between James and Gwendolyn. I think that he admired her and took from her.
Yeah, I agree. That's why I had mentioned her earlier. I actually think that even more so than Hayden. Hayden, I think, had a bigger, more historical perspective, whereas James was a bit more towards the self. I think Brooks's last 15 or 20 years of her life, there was the decline in her work, but her stuff from the 40s through the early 80s, I think there's a very interesting sort of correspondence in terms of subject matter, in terms of overall quality, especially, and both of them could go back and forth between sonnets and more tighter forms, and also doing more personal free verse forms. So yeah, I agree that that Gwendolyn Brooks is probably the poet, at least published poet, that has the most correspondence with James. Jake, where would you put James on a continuum of both Black American and American and or world poets?
Well, yeah, for me, he's in the pantheon. I mean, he's hard to rank because, again, he's not part of a movement. There is this timeless quality about his work. And I wanted to bring up the subject of longevity. The fact that James produced strong work in five different decades, that's an achievement in and of itself. I sometimes link James in my mind with another writer who spent most of his time, much of his time in Paris. That's C.K. Williams. C.K. Williams is also a good friend of mine. Charlie to his friends. It's funny, they didn't know each other, but they shared certain similarities. Charlie Williams has a much more sort of definable style with his long lines and sort of Whitman-esque embrace of everything. But like James, he was his work was very politically engaged when he was younger. And Charlie, unlike James, did have this explosion of recognition after he turned 60. In the space of 5 years, he won the Pulitzer, the National Book Award, and the National Book Critics Circle Award. And I know that wasn't the reason he wrote, but I know he was gratified by that. But they're linked in my mind because I've known them both James, no Charlie, I've known them for a long time. They're both very tall American guys who love France, and this longevity, this just keeping at it and always exploring, always being focused on the work. Maybe it's the age I'm at now, but I appreciate that more and more.
Final point. I just wanted to mention. I know that back almost a decade ago, in 2006, Jean and I think it might have been Marie France and maybe Godelieve Simone, or one of the three of you approached me about a private edition of a book to be published. I know I had written a brief essay about James in there. Did you contribute to that book too?
Was that the seven profiles?
I believe so.
Yeah, I actually think that's what I when I was trying to remember where I wrote this, when I wrote this tribute to James, I think I probably wrote it for seven profiles.
Okay. Yeah. Well, let's end this segment then. In our last major segment, want to talk a bit more about anything else that needs to be said about James. Want to talk a little bit about one of the things since his death. I'm a big supporter of the public domain, and I know since James has no relatives, I want to talk about, because I was in touch with one of his relatives, about getting his work into the public domain and not letting it sort of rot for the next 70 plus years. And I want to talk about some of that, basically the future and what it holds for James Emanuel and his work. And we'll do that in a moment.
The Negro. Never saw him, never can. Hypothetical, haunting man. Eyes a saucer, yes sir, bosser, dice a clicking, razor flicking. The-ness froze him in a dance. A-ness never had a chance.
All right, Jean, you're holding up a book there. What does it say?
Dirty James and Other Poets.
Okay. Now, Jake's going to start off this final segment, and he wanted to read the poem Deadly James, which I guess should be stated if you're just joining us, was about his son. So go ahead, Jake, if you want to read the poem.
Yeah, and I'd just like to say that James made a point of never reading this poem himself aloud. And I think it's so relevant to where we are now. You'll see. It's called, the title is Deadly James, and in parentheses, the subtitle is For All the Victims of Police Brutality. The killer cops, the San Diego Three. What made them think you deadly, James? I take their guilty heads into my arms. I cradle them. My tendons hush their eyes, illumine them to see the years roll back. Your little window, James, unsealed. Your Palomino rocking horse, his glassy eyes unquiet, when the sudden blood that splashed his ivory mane told you the table knife you sucked on was different, could also spit upon the tawny rug, breathtaking tracks. Deadly, James. I embraced their heads more tightly. Their veins bulged to understand you, James. You, hardly old enough to run, dancing solitary in the Brooklyn rain, your older playmates dashed from, your arms and lips and laughter reaching up for all the sky could pour upon the rivers capering inside you. Deadly rivers, James. I hug their heads with strength I saved for you, James. Their eyeballs darken as they strain with me to find you practicing your saxophone, lying in the quilted heaps, your bed poked up around your stocking feet. The littered outpost of that farther wilderness you made your room. No entry blazed across the door to guard your heartbeats when your golden horn believed its one-man note. That wild, sweet loneliness you cried, beguiling neighbors into forgiveness before you fumbled scales beginners know. You began at the top, James, deadly. I clasped their heads more fiercely, empowered by the memory of you, stranded where they bled you down into your smallest drop, gun hammers cocked and nightsticks sinewed, all three bewildered to find beauty defiantly beyond them. A tiny dark brown flower, the grain of you, James, erect, watered back to momentary life by your manful tears. In my iron arms, their heads turn dry, drop hollow to the ground. If your new unearthly wisdom bids you, raise them. But whenever you feel blood again, or rain, or music, pray your innocence be deadlier, James. Much deadlier.
Well, thank you, Jake. I had mentioned in the previous segment, I wanted to talk a little bit about the future of the James Emanuel corpus. And anyone watching this show in the first month or so after it goes online will be seeing it on a YouTube channel called eCosmoetica. I initially had started the show on a Cosmoetica YouTube channel. And the public domain is a big issue for me because one of the reasons I started this channel a bit earlier than I wanted to was because of some public domain issues with YouTube and my using some clips from public domain movies that a company in Germany had claimed. And one of the reasons I support the public domain as an artist and I'm against, very much against, the extension of copyrights is that the copyright has been used in the last couple of hundred years since it emerged as a way for corporations to acquire intellectual property that I don't think they really have. And one of the things that I wanted, and I know that I talked with James about it, is one of the biggest things, he wanted to get his work out there. And as far as I know, he has no nuclear family survivors. His ex-wife, I believe, is dead, and she's now an ex-wife, even if she's still alive. His son is... What?
She's dead, yes.
Okay, and his son is dead. And I know his estate is being handled by a nephew and some other more farther out relatives that I did have a brief correspondence with. And I did urge them to put James's poetry, at least, in the public domain as soon as possible so that it can get on websites like Project Gutenberg or the Internet Archive, so that what happened in 2001, when I wrote, as far as I know, the first critical essay on James's work, doesn't happen with his poetry. I don't want there to be a bottleneck that for 5, 6, 7 decades, his work doesn't emerge until the 2080s. He should not go through the Melville thing. He should not go through the Emily Dickinson thing or the Franz Kafka thing, where his work is secreted away. And so one of the things that I hope in this show, it will show for readers who stumble upon it, Googling his name, that his work deserves a wider audience, and hopefully his estate will agree. And I'm going to send them a link to this when it's published, so that maybe they will understand the import of it. So with that having been prefaced, let me start with Alex again, since he's the demographic that would, I think, a little bit older than the demographic that would benefit from James's work being widely available and not secreted away in these $300 books or the Lotus Press, which I'm sure they're meaning well, but when you're having $40 or $50 hardback books, James's work should be available on Kindle and stuff, because that's the future. So, Alex, if you could just briefly talk a little bit about your ideas about the necessity or the need to get great work, including James's, out there to younger generations in ways that they're going to actually read it.
Well, specifically on public domain and specifically on James Emanuel, one of the things that's been happening in poetry and Black poetry over the last few decades is, you know, you've had this vast store of trash. You know, you can't talk about, you know, James Emanuel and poets like Maya Angelou or Nikki Giovanni or Rita Dove in the same breath for the most part. You just can't do that. And the unfortunate thing is, when this is finally turned around, when, you know, people more or less, how I mentioned in an earlier interview, when they sort of reach this kind of baseline of mediocrity, and people are less concerned with being white, less concerned with being Black, and just concerned with, you know, creating good work of whatever stripe, you know, James Emanuel's work would be the sort of thing that could be looked at on as a forerunner. But it should not be seen as a forerunner 50, 60, or 70 years down the line. You know, the window of opportunity for that kind of influence, it does close with time. It's not fair to James Emanuel as a poet, but more importantly, it's not fair to society. If you think, for example, if Melville's work was, when it was published in 1851, if it was received openly and warmly, and if critics saw exactly what needed to be seen, you probably would not have had the kind of horrific failures and experimentation that you had, you know, from the late 1800s into the early to like perhaps mid 1900s in American writing and European writing, because writers, they were looking for a new means of expression, a way of kind of pushing themselves into modernity without sacrificing, you know, genuine art, and many of them failed. Yet this was already done in 1851. This was done. If they had access to this before, a lot of the waste that occurred during this time period might not have had to occur. People would have had a model that they would have been able to more easily and more quickly transcend it. Yes, Melville might have benefited in his life. You know, that's great for the artist. You know, it's fair to him. But more importantly, it's really society that would have benefited. And although I don't think there's a one-to-one analog between something like scientific inventions and art, you know, it's sort of like having an invention that comes too late. Melville didn't really influence American writing all that much, because when he was rediscovered in the 1920s and 30s, you already had works that, if they were not similar, they were at least trying to do some similar things. I don't want to see this window of opportunity close on James Emanuel. You know, society will progress and art will progress with or without him. The fact is, you know, he does have a unique contribution, and it needs to be made. And this goes for all art and all artists. The quicker that it's out there, the quicker that people can respond to it in a way that is appropriate to the level of talent and the level of execution, the more the society benefits in the long run. Because, you know, you don't simply want greatness 100 years from now or 300 years from now. You want whatever thing they were destined for to come early. You want it to come early so that you don't have to deal with the bullshit that defines every single interim in human history.
Sean, any comments?
No, because to me this is legal business, and I have I'm not in good terms with publishers of poetry.
Okay.
So I don't want to talk about that, and I'm not legally intelligent enough to deal with it.
Jake, any ideas about what I had stated about the need to get James's work out there, and if not through the public domain, What other way do you think there might be an avenue to get his work out there as soon as possible?
Well, we're doing it right now, and I'm going to make sure that my webmaster distributes this video widely. I think this is a great way to at least try and generate more interest in the work. Public domain, you know, I'm of at least two minds on this because I got a stake in this as a published author. I think in James's case, I think that when you consider that there are no direct heirs, and having known James, I think he would be happy to have his work widely distributed in any format available. And again, it's poetry, so that's different from commercial fiction, or let's say fiction that's brought out by large publishing houses. In my own case, you know, I hope I live as long as James Emmanuel does, but having had open heart surgery a few months ago, that's not any guarantee. And if I croak tomorrow, I would like my wife to be the one who's responsible for what happens to the work I leave behind. I would like her to benefit from the copyright. So in terms of my own personal stake in this, I would not necessarily want my work out in the public domain, but I'm a novelist working in the grubby commercial world. So maybe you have to take it on a case-by-case basis, but certainly I think James would be happy to have his work out there in any format possible.
Well, I'm suggesting that, you know, it's the life of the author plus maybe 20, 25 years, or the life of the spouse, say. The thing is, you know, the most infamous case is Stephen Joyce, the grandson of James Joyce, who, as far as I know, met Joyce maybe only twice as a boy, and he was the only surviving descendant. And for 40 or 50 years, I mean, Joyce by that time had gotten the intellectual cachet that James doesn't have at this moment, that his works have survived that kind of terror. But if James had a relative who was in the Stephen Joyce mold, it could really just really set back his place in the canon. And as Alex said, art and the society in general. So that's just my take on it. Jean, you seemed ready to go. So why don't we end up with some closing remarks? And I'll start with you, Jean McGren. If you want to just take a few minutes and say whatever you want to say about the life and career of James Emmanuel.
Well, the idea that he's wanting to be published or widespread is something that I might put a bemol to, because in the last correspondence I had with him, there was a problem about my trying to have some of the translations published by magazines in France, and he strongly objected. He said, I want to know who these people are. Well, I told him they are respectable people. I'm speaking of Siècle 21 and Europe as Revue, which are quite acceptable. And he demurred and objected. So I'm not quite sure he was ready to have his work widespread.
Don't you think, Sean, that maybe he was more concerned about getting ripped off while he was alive and well? I mean, I'm sure he knew Vingt-et-un Siècle. That's a terrific publication.
Well, you have a point here, because he always made a point of paying me. He was very honest, very strict doing business, so that the translations I made belong to him. Well, now that he's dead, I've taken over. They are mine now. But as long as he lived, the translations were his, and I never published anything that had been done with him without asking him, because one, he didn't want me to do it, and two, I just didn't feel like doing it.
Well, if I can interject, I know in 2011, I think in the last couple of years of his life, James had lost track of who held copyrights or who was his publisher too, because in 2011 he had asked me about, and he sent me a letter asking me to go contact a local university or university presses around the country about publishing a larger extended version of his collected poems or a larger whole grain, and I remember I looked up Lotus Press, and I couldn't even find it with Google at the time. And I sent around queries to about 30 or 40 presses, and I believe it was the University of Nebraska Press that came back to me and said that they had checked, but Lotus still held the U.S. rights. And as I mentioned, Lotus Press, you know, I'm sure they're well-meaning, but their books, their website wasn't even available online for a long time. The books are very highly priced, and that's part of, other than the public domain issue, that there's not, I mean, James should have a reprint or an expanded version of Whole Grain with a Random House or a Simon & Schuster, or yep, even a New Directions that, yeah, that would do it justice.
James is very frustrated with Lotus Press, I can tell you. And I mean, writers, when we get together, we mainly complain, you know, mainly complain about agents, publishers, and critics. But he was very unhappy with Lotus Press. And that might be, Jean, one reason why he was wary of publishing elsewhere and being abused.
Yeah.
But I also think he absolutely wanted a wider readership.
And I
guess he
would have been happy to have a major publishing house. I think really the best thing that could happen for James right now would be if just in terms of, you know, practical purposes, if a well-known African-American academic took up this cause,
yeah,
and got some of James's poems published posthumously in the New Yorker or a place like that, then this could actually happen. But somebody has to take that initiative. I mean, I'm just talking about, you know, the way things work. I'm not saying what's right or wrong, but...
And I suggested to his nephew, I was informed by James that his nephew, I won't mention his name, but his nephew was the executor. But then the nephew told me that someone else in the family was. And I suggested to them, his work needs to be put in a Variety edition in a university press, like the University of Nebraska. That would be the perfect place, his home state, the state university, you know, that could put out Force in the Reckoning, the collected poems, any other miscellany or letters that someone, you know, over the next 20 years. But that was my idea. So, Jake, if you have a final, Jake, go ahead. Jake, if you want to have a final say on James' career, life, whatever.
Yeah, I'd just like to say, you know, I think one of the things that I learned from James is that the all you can do as a writer is live the best life you can and get the work done. I mentioned C.K. Williams earlier. Another person I think of when I think of James is Mavis Gallant, who also lived in Paris, a Canadian writer, principally a short story writer, was also a good friend of mine, also died in 2013 in her 90s. And like James, she was just totally dedicated. And to see that level of concentration and commitment to the work, it's a beautiful thing. I think a lot of writers are so concerned with getting ahead or getting money or, you know, knowing the right people. Mavis and James were completely committed to the work. They were different people. Mavis was much more sociable than James was. But I'm so honored to have known them and feel that I learned so much from their example of just being a committed writer.
Let me just end with Alex, since we're talking about the future and you represent some of the younger readers that James, even after his death, would like to read to reach. If you would just give a couple of minutes your thoughts on James Emanuel.
Well, I'm just going to second what Jake more or less said. You know, the bottom line is we have some opportunities now, all of us being younger than James Emanuel. You know, we're all writing in some capacity. We have opportunities now that he did not get in his lifetime. And, you know, we need to simply get to the bottom line and work. You know, I'm working on my next novel now. Next year, there's going to be another book. And the year after that, there's going to be a new book. And, you know, we should want these things for ourselves. We should
want to get the work done in the same way that he himself would want us to do this sort of thing for art. You know, he didn't simply do it for himself. We're not doing it for ourselves, although that could be a side benefit. We need to simply get whatever we need to get out into the world and hope that the world can learn from it and move on.
Well, thanks to all three of the people. Both Jake Lamar and Alex Sheremet have eponymous websites, jakelamar.com and alexsheremet.com, that if you enjoyed what they were saying in this show, you can go there and read more of their work. Jean, I don't believe you have a website, but thanks for participating as well. Anyone who found this interesting, go Google James Emmanuel, find his work. If you're interested in finding out more about it, Google is the best thing. Hopefully someday in the near future, James's work will be more widespread, both online and offline. Hopefully there may be, in the next 5 or 10 years, collected variety editions of his writing, both prose and poetry. My next show will be switching gears. We will be talking about racial and sexual identity with researchers I use the collective we, but it's I'll be talking with researchers on both race and sex, and that'll be in a couple of weeks. But again, thank you to Jake Lamar, Jean McGrenn, and Alex Sheremet.
Thank you, Dan Schneider.
Bye.
Okay. Goodbye.
To kill a morning spider, like a thick black pencil mark whipped suddenly across the pine wood floor, his blot at the bed corner leaped to my tightening shoe, swelled into an eight-legged coil, oozing fur, it seemed, angering to be recognized as spider. He quivered once, in a paroxysm seized his stomach, grip something there. A tiny thing hopped from him, whirling, just as my foot, clutching at itself, smashed his eight legs. The wheeling little thing, in pausing, killed itself. My shoe, an engine on its own, crushed what was there. Such his surprise, his destiny, a spider in disguise, an insect fleeing, and we watchers from our sleep awaking to close their beam.